So welcome to our gathering, and we are absolutely thrilled to share with you today OpenSpace, which you're going to hear all about through our guests. But basically, this is a NASA-funded project that's seeded out of the American Museum of Natural History, and it's a very powerful visualization tool, as you'll see, that hopefully you may find yourself wanting to use one day for a variety of different applications in your life, whether it be education or outreach or research. So without further ado, I am going to turn it over to you, Megan, to get the ball rolling. And thank you all again for being here. Oh, and please do mute your microphones, if you will. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Oh, resume share. Can you all see my slides?
We see your form, actually.
Oh, why is awkward?
Well, that's all right. I don't know where it went. Form anyways. It yes. Wasn't a secret form or anything.
No. Okay, here. I think I dragged a tab accidentally. Here we go. Okay. Now we good?
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Looks great. All right.
Thank you. So I'm going to kick us off. My name is Megan Villa. I am the project coordinator for the Open Space Project out of the American Museum of Natural History in New York City. And so I'm just going to give you a brief rundown of what Open Space is, how people use it, and kind of give you some ideas before we give you a demonstration. So here we go. So like Daniela said, OpenSpace is funded by NASA through the Science Activation grants, and it is an open source interactive data visualization software designed to visualize the entire known universe. So we start you out at Earth, and you can go all the way out to the cosmic microwave background. And in between there, there's a whole lot of data that you can visualize. And it's also dynamic, so it includes observation, simulations, 3D models of space mission, like telescopes, and operations. So all of this work involves a lot of different partners. So our development partners who work on the code of the software includes people at the American Museum of History in Natural History in New York City, Linköping University in Sweden, New York University in New York, the University of Utah, and NASA Community Coordinated Modeling Center. And then we also have informal science institutions who work with the software and use it in their museums or planetariums and also help us make it better. And that includes the Adler Planetarium, California Academy of Sciences, Denver Museum of Nature and Science, Houston, and North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences, which our speaker, Rachel Smith, is from. So some use cases. Primarily, OpenSpace was started as a software to use in full-dome planetarium shows to live fly rather than being a canned video. But since then, it has evolved and you can use it in a lot of different formats. So this image is the JWST model in OpenSpace showing images from Worldwide Telescope in the planetarium at the American Museum of Natural History in New York. Then you can also use it for virtual programs. So especially in the last several years, live stream programs have really picked up. And so you can do a lot of amazing things by streaming to YouTube with OpenSpace. And then you can also create kiosks. So these kiosks are at the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences, where Rachel's from. And there are different videos that guests can click on, and they've been a really big hit. And we have a lot of different models for this at different institutions. And also social media content. So this is a short reel from Instagram on Jupiter's moons by CCNY Planetarium in New York. So this is just to kind of illustrate the breadth of different ways that you can use OpenSpace, no matter if you're presenting for young children or for adults. There's a lot of different content to fit your needs, including you could add your own data sets, which we will get to that in a second. So And so here's our contact information. I will share these slides, but now I'm going to pass it over to our software integration engineer at the American Museum of Natural History, Micah Achinapura, and he is going to pilot OpenSpace live for us while Dr. Rachel Smith from North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences gives us basically a presentation that she would do, but she'll walk us through more of behind the scenes open space while she's doing it. All right, Micah.
Awesome. So let me just share my open space here. So is everybody seeing the solar system now?
Yes.
Great. And so, you know, me and Rachel will have a little back and forth, but mostly Rachel will be guiding us.
So let me know.
Yeah, go for it.
Rachel. Okay. So hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. And thanks, Megan and Micah, for including me in this. Yeah, I've been on the project since the beginning, and I think it's amazing, the software, and I use it a lot. And what I'm going to show is some elements of programs that I've done that I think help inspire stories that you can tell with OpenSpace. A lot of it connected to astrobiology, but you have used open space for guest speakers talking about, for example, the curator and Denton Abel, who's also on the project from the American Museum, talking about Mercury, for example, or we've had other speakers come where you can use open space that way to supplement. I use it in teaching. I teach astrobiology. And so it's a really valuable tool. So what I'm going to talk about is just some locations. And so, and also, by the way, I use it for various public audiences, and including, for example, like tomorrow morning, I'm talking to the board here, and these are folks that don't, you know, I never take it for granted what people know. And so therefore I start here. I thought it'd be fun to start just with the solar system and remember that people need a context to get into something. And so we know this for exhibits and also for programs, and you start with what they know. This is maybe a little even abstracted, but you could start with Earth and pull back. But here we're just starting with the solar system and just showing that these are the orbits. Most people, I'd say, know the Earth is part of a solar system, and just giving that context, there are 8 planets and we're one of them. And you could show, we don't have to show this now because I didn't even mention it to Micah when we were talking, but like the habitable zone, you can turn these on and off. We have there's tons of exoplanetary systems in open space that you can add in. There it is, the habitable zone. So you can start off by saying, you know, we're the only planet with life, and this is what a habitable zone is. And I would use this for like an event where there's people who know something about astronomy, maybe, where you're talking about the search for life and what a habitable zone means, and talk about, you know, all sorts of different things you could mention. If you tip the solar system, like if you show it like a dinner plate, Micah, so you can show the plane of the planets and then from there, you know, I'm a disk observer, so I do research on protoplanetary disks, and sometimes I show this to lead into my work. And I will just mention, we're not showing this today, but you can also include images like slides in open space, and so you can overlay them and just turn them on and off. And that's helpful too if you're showing data, for example. So if I'm giving a talk for like an astronomy club and they want to see some data that you're working on, I'll do that too. But there's the plane of the disk. And then you could say, oh, you know, sometimes I like to show, and we're going to turn these on, show the remnants of disk formation. And those would be the asteroids and comets. And I will just say, in starting programs, and you could show these, Micah, if you want to flip it, there you go. And you can flip this and show that we have these remnants, and talk about asteroids and comets. And these are huge data sets, which really slow down the software. So we're only going to show a couple of them. And you can select which ones to add in to open space. I will say it's wonderful we could have Micah like stay next to me all the time and drive. That would be great. But don't laugh too hard. Hey.
No, and I would say that generally when you're doing this, you're both piloting.
Yes. I want to make sure it's clear. You can pilot it, and I like to drive. You can pilot it and talk at the same time. So it is possible. What it's nice about these asteroids, so the comets are farther, you know, their trajectories reach farther out. So that's shown as longer lines in open space. And here you can talk about, we turn on the Trojans and talk about the effect of Jupiter. You could bring that in. You can zoom in. You can enlarge the size of planets too and actually show Jupiter if you wanted to do that. You don't have to do, I mean, it's up to you. You can, Mike is not showing the menu right now. He has this split, but when you run open space, you can have a menu that you, the menu comes up and down. And sometimes I deliberately leave that on to show people so they can see what you can do to control it. So here are the asteroids and the kinds of programs I typically do. And especially for this group today is we could talk about astrobiology, and there's so many things, of course, that relate to that. So I like to start off with the asteroids. They're really cool. And it looks great in open space, I think. And then from there, after talking, you know, I've done a whole program on impacts only and kind of just toured around the asteroid belt. But for astrobiology, I then go into Earth, and from there, and you can talk, you know, segue into the effects of impacts on planets. So we'll go to Meteor Crater, for example. And open space shows this beautifully, and Michael will go there, and you can get, you know, the resolution is amazing. And you can get really close to the surfaces. Earth has amazing data sets, of course. You know, from Earth, Moon, and Mars are the best to see the surface. And so we want to highlight that with open space. And so there are a couple of locations I talk about for astrobiology, and there's many more. Okay, so these are just ones I've selected in the past. So Meteor Crater is a great one. A lot of people know it and several have been there, and that brings back a memory for them, which is nice, or they don't maybe know about it. And then it's an opportunity to learn about this really well-preserved crater. And I can talk, you can talk about how, you know, it's a small impact and all of these things. You could bring in all sorts of storylines to craters and how they can actually visit it. And it, you know, 50,000 years ago, and how it wouldn't have affected the lives as much, but, you know, you can bring in, of course, the dinosaur extinction. And I sometimes have imagery that I bring in there, and you can show, and we're not going to go here just for sake of time, but you can show the region of the Yucatan with open space where Chicxulub is. And actually you can turn the map for Chicxulub, that crater in Mexico off the coast, is, and then overlay the actual location right on top of open space. And so you can actually see, bring that in if you're interested in talking about extinctions. And here, of course, you can bring in all sorts of history, even Apollo, because they train the Apollo astronauts in Meteor Crater. And so down in that shaft in the center, which you can see in the lower right. So there are all these different uses for these regions. And I even did a whole presentation, as they have in New York too, of course, on Apollo. And you can bring in, you know, connections with Earth in lots of ways. So Meteor Crater is awesome. Then nearby for astrobiology, I usually go to Grand Prismatic Spring because of extremophiles, but you can also show the Grand Canyon. It's just not far away, and it looks really nice if you want to bring in just a cool location. But for astrobiology, unless you're kind of talking about comparative planetology and you want to show that in comparison to Valles Marineris, that's another really great use of open space, is looking at comparative planetology. And you can look at, and I know I'm going off of the story a little bit, but you can compare, you know, shield volcanoes like Mauna Kea to Olympus Mons on Mars and Valles Marineris and the different ways of formation of the different canyons. So there are all sorts of really interesting surface stories you can tell with open space, because it shows the surface layers really nicely. So Grand Prismatic Spring is, everyone I'm sure here knows about it. And for people, it's very interesting to that. It's interesting to them often to know that this is a place where extremophiles live, and that this was an inspiration for astrobiology. Some of the first extremophiles were discovered here, and connecting that with possible life, you know, on Mars, although I usually add the caveat that it's unlikely to be exactly like this life, of course. And, you know, we can't get under the ocean to a hydrothermal vent with open space, but this is an example of the type of life we expect to find. And you can see the really nice resolution here, and you can even see people on that path that looks updated. Because when I looked at it recently, it didn't have all those people.
Yeah, it updates.
It updates Earth a lot. Yeah, it does. It did get better. It's amazing. And the colors. And so I use this as a prime region for extremophiles. And then from here, another location you could go to are not often thought of as much are the San Francisco salt flats, which some people have seen from the planes that they take, or maybe even didn't even know they were there. And then you can bring in, and you don't have to do all of these obviously in one program, but you could talk about halophiles from the San Francisco salt flats. We'll see how good they look right now. It does change. Sometimes they look not so great. It depends on the day. But each day I'd give a program, I'll test it and make sure that I like the location that day. And it usually doesn't change that often, but sometimes I check it out. Sometimes they're more colorful than other days. So let's see how today looks.
Yesterday.
Pretty good yesterday. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that's pretty nice. Not quite as, yeah, that's good. That's decent. So, but they are remarkable, and they have an interesting story too, just that they were developed for, as far as I understand, for cultivation of salt. And then these extremophiles came over, and I think, and you correct me if I'm wrong there, I haven't talked about them in a while, but they are interesting. And I like to connect them with astrobiology, just another location on Earth where we can study these life forms and then connect to the search for life beyond Earth. And then, you know, and with open space, you can go anywhere on Earth really and see anything. It's pretty amazing. I've shown the museum I work at. You can show places in New York. It's really nice. So from here for astrobiology, I'll go to, Lake Salda, which is the analog to Jezero crater, let's go there, Micah. But also as an observer, I use the telescopes on Mauna Kea, and you can see the observatories with open space. You can go to the Big Island of Hawaii and see all those telescopes. And then I'll segue, if I'm talking about my research, to that, in that way. But as far as like, if you want to talk about analog locations, Lake Salda is a great example, since they studied the microbiolites around the shore to learn more about what possibly could be around Jezero. And it's a pretty cool lake, actually. It's got a really distinctive shoreline. It's pretty beautiful. So here we go. And so that whole, you could talk all about the shore and the kind of mineralization there, and then compare to what's been found on Jezero. That's cool. And we may not always think of this place. We've talked a lot about, I try not to stay always focused on the United States. There are a lot of cool places. So there's this one, there's like Chicxulub, if you're talking about craters, and there's plenty of other places. There's the Rio Tinto, although it doesn't always look so good in open space or in general. I think it's not as spectacular as it should look or something. But Rio Tinto in Spain is also a really interesting location to check out. Anything on the surface can be seen with open space really well. So this is a pretty interesting location. And then from here, I would go to Mars. I sometimes don't have time to do all of these things. So you have to pick and choose. And I try not to stuff too much. It's always hard because you want to talk about everything. I try not to stuff too much in one program. And usually the ones that get the best responses are ones where I've kind of cut some stuff out, so it's not too overwhelming for people. And so from here, you know, whatever you do on Earth, and then you can pop right over to Mars. And I like to make sure people know that all the stars are in the right place, and we can globe browse and go from any point, like Megan was saying, to any point without really skipping data sets. And that's what is a really amazing asset to open space is, it versus, say, people are familiar with Eyes on the Solar System. You can't really do that and have this seamless connection between Earth and its location and other planets, and you can drive immediately. You can also pop over there. There's a way to go right to...
We could teleport there.
You can teleport, exactly. There's a way to do it. I prefer not to do that because it takes it out of context, I feel like, a little bit, but you can go faster if you wanted to. But we're talking about seconds. It's not a huge amount of time. So Mars is, of course, like a rich surface for so many things. You could go to so many places, and we're just going to go to Jezero, but I'll just say that there's, you can see the dune fields of Nili Patera. You can see all sorts of, you can fly through Valles Marineris. You can turn on height layers and show the colorized height layers. You can turn on high resolution data sets, which we'll see when we get close. And you can go to Olympus Mons and talk about, if I show Olympus Mons, I like to compare it to the shield volcano of Mauna Kea. And, you know, just again, it talks about the context of planet formation. But Jezero is a good one. We're there now, and for lots of reasons, it's the latest, but it has that connection with Lake Salda, and it is really nice and open space. It looks really good, and you can get pretty close and see, and you can see all of these really, see, I love that area. Are we at Jezero?
Yeah, we're coming into it.
You're coming in. So you could, but if you stop for a second,
yeah,
those little, if I'm not mistaken, that's wind action, those little features that are coming in from the left, that I think is either it's some aspect of erosion or something. I don't know.
These sweepers.
Yeah, they're really pretty cool.
Are these the ones that I'm zooming
in? Yeah. Those awesome. Little, those are pretty cool. So yeah, so I study a lot when I'm doing these programs to just to make sure I have enough information. I can, whatever I want to show to learn more about, because I'm not a geologist, but I want to learn more about the places I go to. There it is. Jezero becomes easier to find. It's small, but once you remember the distinctive kind of flower that it looks like on the shoreline there, you can find it. I can find it a little faster than I used to be able to. So this is really nice. You can see the delta coming in, the remnants of that. And you can show roughly where Jezero landed, where Perseverance landed, kind of roughly between those two craters right there in the foreground, and talk about, you know, the mission, talk about caching samples, talk about water in the past. I usually mention something about terraforming, like what the, if I'm thinking about that, you know, if we do a Mars program, I'll talk about terraforming and what needs to happen, even if Mars had water in the past, what its situation is now. And I might show something about the atmosphere and solar wind stripping as an image overlay. You can see if you tilt Mars a little bit, you can see the atmosphere, I think, is on. And you can show in this version of OpenSpace, you can't see the stars, as I learned. In my version, I have a one step back. I have to update it. But you can turn, the stars are a little bit larger, so you can see them, even though it's not as realistic. I like this, but...
Make them show.
You can show them. Yeah.
Yeah.
You can turn them up and down. So sometimes, so in mine, you see them, they look, it's one of these, I guess, artistic, sort of artistic license. They're a bit bigger, so you can see them just like that. But it isn't what you'd exactly see on Mars. You could turn them back and forth, but you can see all those, all that wind, like at the shoreline there, those ripples. It's just pretty amazing. There's so much you could talk about at Jezero. You know, people are interested in Mars. So it's a great location to go to, especially for the public. And then for my students, you know, it's a lot more interesting to do this than boring slides all the time.
The Nili Patera is close by if you want.
Yeah, let's go to Nili Patera. I love Nili Patera. It's really pretty cool. It's volcanic. You can see the really striking difference in the volcanic and the basaltic material. It's pretty great. I think the data set's rather small, so you can drive through it pretty fast. Those are those, what do you call them, sweepers?
Was just making that.
Oh. And thus they shall be called sweepers.
Science term there.
Were there any questions while we go there? Let's see. You can do a session. Oh, good, Megan's. Okay, well, let me know if there's anything anyone wants to ask me. But there's tons of stuff to talk about with Mars. And I will say to my students, I hire interns. I don't have interns this summer purposefully, but I do hire interns. They can learn it very fast. They've created all the videos. Like we'll talk about a storyline and we'll talk about getting clips, and they'll take clips from OpenSpace using OBS. We use OBS, which is free. And then they push it through Premiere, Adobe Premiere, which isn't free, but we have a license here, and put text on. And so they create these little films for the lab, and they can do it. They're undergrads that I hire. And so this is Nili Patera, and it's just a really pretty alien looking region, I think. And so we have it on our videos. We have it as a, I think it's on our kiosks. I have to check, but it's pretty amazing. And this is the high rise, right? Isn't this the high rise data set? Yeah. So you can see it. It's also, I will say, OpenSpace is a great for discussing data in general. And I think that's really important, what data mean to people, and they don't know. The public is does not necessarily know what that means. And I'm talking about visualization, how we get data. We've had people say, well, mostly, I guess, young adults who might say, how do you even know, or maybe not even young adults, but how do you even know what it is if we haven't gone there? And they don't know anything really about remote sensing. And so it's a great way to communicate this to people. And I think it's our job too, as scientists in a museum, especially, to communicate this. How do we get information? Because a lot of people, I think, don't understand that. They're on Earth, they see it in their front of their face, and that's it. And they don't think we make it up, but they don't really know that you can get all this information just from remote sensing, that and beyond, right? This surface, which they can connect to, but galaxies and all these other places. So Mars is a rich environment. There's tons of stuff. You can go all over the place, and you can turn data sets on and off. So there's, like, you could do many programs on Mars, but for astrobiology, if I can fit it in, I'll go to Europa and Titan. And also, Micah, before you go to these places, show the nest of moons, because that's really cool. So before, so we'll do Jupiter and Saturn.
Oh, yeah.
You're right. Let's just do Saturn. But I will say, so we'll go to Europa, but both of these planets have this really amazing nest of moons. And we turned on, I mentioned, Mike is right, we were just going to show Saturn, because they're kind of like little systems in and of themselves. And you can show that, especially really nicely with Saturn, because the rings are like a plane closer to the planet. And then further out, you get this really beautiful nest of moons. And it shows like what these big planets can do in capturing moons, and that they're little moonlets you can talk about in the rings. And Saturn really has a spectacular view of that. So we'll go to first Europa and see how that looks. And that, well, you know, we don't have a huge amount of data right on Europa. We have to go back there. So this is from, I believe these are these Voyager data or other data? Do you know where?
Voyager.
Okay.
Global Mosaic.
Okay. So we're going to zoom over to Europa, and then
should I turn on the nest now, or
you can, or we could just do the one for Saturn if you want. It doesn't matter, because I didn't mention. Yeah, it's up to you. We can, but there it is. Okay, yeah, it's on.
So now we're in Europa.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll fly by. There's a lot, of course, you could say about Jupiter. And I don't usually talk a lot about Jupiter, but there's certainly enough to say. And then Europa as the next target. You could, and I will say for missions, there's a lot you could talk about with OpenSpace as a backdrop for that. So we have Europa Clipper and all of these missions that are going to the outer planets now. So yeah, so the you can see the cracks really nicely. You can turn off the shading, by the way. We could show people. Well, you can't show them, but you can do this. You just turn off shading or do global illumination. And there are some hotkeys for that, some buttons that can turn on and off. And Mike, I don't know if you mentioned there's tutorials online for OpenSpace, how to use stuff. Their instructions. And so you can talk all about the ice under the surface and everything. and all sorts of, and if you really are excited about surface geology of Europa, which I'm not an expert in, there's a lot you could mention here, I'm sure, with fissures and whatnot. So from there, I would go to Titan, and there we'll show the nest of moons.
Cool.
And you can see, it's really nice. You'll see the nest, and then you can zoom in and you'll see the beautiful rings. And it's like our little solar system, like a mini solar system within the solar system. And the rings of Saturn are pretty awesome. So I'll just, so this is not a single program I'm talking about. These are just sort of like highlights, I'd say, of various programs. So this is the nest of moons and around, and Jupiter has that too, more or less looks the same from if you pull back. But when you zoom in for Saturn, you can see the beautiful rings and how they form a plane more around the planet. And it's an opportunity to talk to people about planet formation, and you could even bring in orbital dynamics, all sorts of ways to incorporate the data sets. And you can see the hexagon also on the North Pole. If you turn off shading, you can see that. So you can talk about that as well. And pretty much whatever, there's the moons turned on. Oh, lots of moons. So anyway, so that's nice. And then here's Titan. And again, another nice mission coming up would be Dragonfly in the next decade, hopefully. And a nice way to bring in possible life, maybe in the outer solar system, if it's not water-based. But there's a lot of, Titan is interesting for lots of reasons. So primordial Earth, all sorts of stuff. And so Titan's a really good place to go as well. And then we could turn on the exoplanets, those data sets. So there's the Kepler data sets, and it's just a handful of data, I'm pretty sure. So so we'll go around Titan and then turn those on. You could also turn on the radio. Do you want to turn on the radiosphere first? Well, we could do that last. We'll turn on the exoplanets. So that is, and these can turn on and off anytime you want to show them. And so we'll turn on those bubbles, and then the blue ones. Oh, there we go. Yeah. So the nice thing is when you pull back, you can see the layout and just this kind of handful of data that we have. And I like talking about also the fact that we haven't been there, and the renderings you see our artistic renderings, and all of these are just visualized as locations, really, more or less, right? We know some composition a bit, but we don't have this like really amazing surface data that is implied with sometimes press releases and whatnot. So you can see our exoplanets, and you can do this with the radiosphere too, but I'll just say, like, if you pull back, maybe pull back to show the galaxy in context. I will eventually show this in a program with astrobiology, because I'll end with SETI, and just show kind of like when you pull back and see where we are. And sometimes I show it as the radiosphere, which is a sphere that shows up at this scale. You can see within 100 light years, you could actually see the point of the radiosphere. But with these exoplanets, you can get the same idea, is that we are at this tiny planet. These are the exoplanets we've observed, basically. And this is one galaxy. And then, of course, you can pull back to everything if you want. But there's the radiosphere. Micah, thanks. Turn that on. You can change the opacity of the radiosphere to show exoplanets within there if you want, or just talk about it. And this is the connection with SETI, with OpenSpace. And then that can bring in any sorts of discussions. You know, I talk about the Voyager mission, anything you really want to bring in there, Carl Sagan and his influence and everything.
Rachel, if it looks like more than usual, I'm realizing it's because we updated the data set.
Yeah, it does. It looks really nice. Yeah, very nice. It does look, it extended farther out than I remember.
Yeah, me too. All of a sudden.
Yeah, I was like, wow. Well, that's good, because it goes up all the time. And then, you know, we'll show people, like, if you turn off the exoplanet data sets to then turn on each exoplanet? Because if you zoom in to an exoplanet and the bubbles are on, they start to flicker. And unless that went away, but it's easier to just turn on something like I told Micah we could go to TRAPPIST-1 maybe. And just as one example, and there are, you can pull up really any exoplanetary system, I'm going to say, although I'm sure I'll be wrong, but anything I've wanted to look at has been in the data sets, like 55 Cancri, or, you know, just anything that NASA has been talking about. And sometimes those travel posters that NASA has of like, go to a lava world, and then you can show the system. They are, I always mention this, it's, you know, the OpenSpace has done an amazing job of putting in all these data sets. But the one thing is that each exoplanetary system only has one star, just to be able to get it in the software. So a future update might be to put in all the systems, but it's all the stars, yeah. But then the orbital dynamics gets really complicated. So the point of showing these in open space is not necessarily exactly the system, but to show a habitable zone here. TRAPPIST-1, you can talk about the four Earth-like planets in the habitable zone and even closer to the habitable zone. And then I'll show, you know, you could show any kind of overlay like the NASA travel poster, which I'll have all lined up anyway in the, I have all the, if I'm going to show imagery, you know, I organize that ahead of time.
We also have for each system, the 1AU circle.
The what now?
The 1AU circle. So show this system compared to 1AU.
Oh, wow. I didn't even know they were so close. And that's still, because it's a red dwarf or brown dwarf, right? That's why they're huddled up so
close. Yeah.
That's interesting. Yeah, I didn't even appreciate that. So, So I guess, I mean, that's 241. So I don't know if we were thinking that if people wanted to go somewhere here, I mean, I just kind of went through really fast these highlights of what I show with OpenSpace. And then, you know, I have several programs that I've given with OpenSpace, and they all are a little different depending on what you're trying to do. And for teaching, you know, I teach undergraduates, and especially for the general education students, this is a really, really useful tool. They do not, and I know this from student evaluation, they love OpenSpace. They see it in context and they're amazed. Not so much, maybe, I mean, partly the software, but really amazed at their location in the universe. And I am consistently impressed by that they don't know this. And I feel like we should all never forget that to reach people who are not scientists and get them excited, we have to start where they are. And where they are is not knowing where we are, I think. And this is true for the general public in a lot of ways. Some know, but not everybody. And I think the impact is greatest when we can start with the context they understand. And OpenSpace does a great job of doing that. So, I guess, is there anyone who wants to go someplace that we haven't gone? Or if, Micah, you want to show us something else?
Yeah, I think maybe, there was just one or two that I had in here that we didn't turn on. Okay. Other asteroids, we had these were the Kuiper Belt ones.
Oh, cool.
I don't know if you usually talk about those.
Oh, the Kuiper, I don't have a Pluto program so much, but yeah, there's all of these data sets that you can add in, like these, they're called assets, and you add them into OpenSpace. You can create your own different programs. I just kind of have a big one called Astrobiology, and I just shove a lot of things in there, and then you can turn them on and off in your programs. They don't all turn on at one time, but you can click, they'll be in your menu once you add them. And then you can do a whole thing on these, all these different data sets. Oh, we forgot the potentially hazardous.
That's what this one is. Yeah.
Yeah. So I forgot to mention, because I didn't write it down in my list, is going to Meteor Crater, we would, before we went there, which I forgot to mention, are the potentially hazardous asteroids that are of interest, of course. And they, you know, I would lead in to before going to Earth to talk about that. And you can turn on time like Mike is doing here. And show, you know, you could even, I've created little clips of like enlarging Earth and showing up close kind of the asteroids swirling around and just giving that whole discussion. It's asteroid day on Friday. I know, because I had to write a blog for it. That's how I know it's,
awesome.
It's a holiday or whatever it is. And so we have, and as you know, I'm a curator of meteorites here. So I like just love to talk about meteorites, and this is a perfect way to do it. And I've even, what I also like to do with open space is thinking of, you know, the next phase of what could we do with it is connecting with exhibits more. We have the kiosks, but also we have a few art pieces near the kiosks from historically from when we opened, but I'm thinking of more meteorite. You know, I was able to incorporate open space with a lunar exhibit by showing Apollo. Because it's a lunar, we have a lunar sample and we have a lunar meteorite, and we did a whole little movie about Apollo 17. With asteroids, we can do, I'm hoping to create another little kind of exhibit with a meteorite and potentially hazardous asteroids and really showing the asteroid belt. And that would be a way to link it visually to meteorites. And so I think there's a lot of potential with using these clips to enhance exhibits. And visitors do like our art pieces as well. And they're right next to the science. And so they see them pointing and whatever. And so I think it's a nice balance. And so open space can be, and it's visually really nice. And so you can create little movies, and this will be my next thing to think about. So I don't know. Does anyone have any questions more than what Megan was answering? Thank you, Megan, for answering. Go ahead. Sorry.
I think I was talking over someone. So whoever that was, please go ahead.
No, it was just me. I think I said, oh, or something. No.
Okay. So this is Daniela. I'm curious about how you refresh the data sets. And I'm curious about that in and of itself. But also, if you know, when we start using it on our own, do we have to do anything to make sure that happens? Or how does that work?
Yeah.
That's a good Micah question. Yeah.
Yeah. Perfect. I guess we have the thing. It's only a bit of a loaded question in that we have lots of different data sets. So there isn't exactly one answer for one different thing, but we'll put out a different release of the software every single year, and we'll refresh the data sets every year as we release it. Not every single data set gets updated every year, and then there's some other data sets the Earth imagery and Earth satellite data that gets loaded from the web. But something like the exoplanet data sets, we will update that every year when we put a new release. But we also provide like a task file thing that we have where if you wanted to update the exoplanet data set like during the year before us, you could run the same thing that we just run once a year, and you could update it, which just downloads it from that. I believe it's the Exoplanet Archive.
Okay.
And so different, each data set has its own different kind of thing. The star data set, we update once every maybe three versions from the digital universe.
Okay. So is it self-evident within the software how to do that if we want to do updates more frequently than you do?
Well, I guess I would say no, but then different data sets that we do have that you can update, we have like some instructions on the wiki about how you can update them. For example, that the asteroid data set, we get those from the JPL Horizons Solar System Small Body browser or something. I forget exactly the last.
I think it's Small Bodies Database.
Exactly, Small Body Database. And so that one we'd update every year. But if you wanted to update that, you know, because this month they discovered a new thing and it's posted and you want to either just show that one trail or it to be in the group, we on our wiki, there is instructions about how to update from the JPL Horizons. So it's not necessarily like in the software, like the data set in the menu says, oh, this type is updatable or that type is updatable, but as you use the software, you would learn the different types Oh, all these asteroid ones. Okay. Those ones come from JPL Horizons. Oh, the exoplanet ones come from TESS. Oh, the maps come from NASA Gibbs.
Awesome. Thank you. And thanks, Megan, for posting a link to the wiki.
Yeah.
Julia had her hand up, I think.
Yeah.
Hi, this is so cool. I've worked in several planetariums before, and this really feels like the UniView software.
Well, that's not a coincidence in that the team who made this is also the team who previously made the UniView software.
And it's the same data, we should say, right?
Oh. Yeah.
It's the digital universe. The digital universe is in open space. So you're getting the free. That was the first thing that was impressed upon me when I started is that, oh, it's the same data. So it looks amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool. So my question is, any sort of dome renderings that you could, like if you had a spherical projector, like display this on a dome?
So we use it in our dome. Built it for domes. And one of the great things about it, though, is that you can use this. I'm showing it to you in a flat screen, but I could also launch it in a fisheye rendering, or I could launch it in a spherical mirror rendering, or I could launch it in an equirectangular 360 rendering. And so one of the powers of OpenSpace is these, what we call display options, display formats, configurations, whatever you want to call it, these different ways that we can make OpenSpace show up for different types of screens and different types of experiences. So it can be 3D for a 3D TV or projector. It can be all these different things. You can even have it with the old black, red and blue 3D glasses.
Oh, cool. And what about the Oculus, Google?
Right
the
now,
virtual reality?
It doesn't work with the virtual reality headsets the way that a game does, with when you run a game and have the controllers and you're playing a game. But where you can use it in the virtual reality headsets is one of those outputs, just like you were thinking of a dome rendering. There's a output for the YouTube 360 rendering. Mm-hmm. So you can output them to those and then they can just play them on YouTube in the thing and be watching, it's playing the movie, but you're also looking around and have the 360 VR experience that way.
Cool. I have one last question and thank you for those answers.
Yeah.
Is this website available in all countries?
Yeah, it's all free. It's totally everything, 100% for the whole world. It's not a website, it's a software. I'm running software on my computer. But
okay, gotcha.
Our website where you download the software is available in all countries.
Great.
And it's we're NASA funded. So our partnership and our funding only stays within the US, but we also work with another university in Sweden. They get their own funding over in Sweden. So it's definitely an international collaboration and international software, and everything's on GitHub. So it's
cool.
100% worldwide based.
Great. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah. And we are working on a website version, so to speak, kind of a version of this where you streaming it on a website that could then be accessed from a Chromebook or something like that. It's a project we got a grant on. We're trying to build, and that also would be available in all countries. Awesome.
This is Daniela. I have another question.
Great. Yeah.
Okay. So forgive my ignorance and in the head right now, but, okay, so we could download this on our computers and serve this basically offline?
When you, the only thing you need the internet for once you've downloaded it is the maps of the planets. So we have some lower resolution versions that you can use if you have no internet, but you can't zoom all the way into Meteor Crater and stuff if you don't have the internet. or like, you know, to see the rover tracks on Mars and stuff.
Okay.
But if that's the only thing that uses the internet, everything else, all these asteroids, all these galaxies, you know, the solar system, everything you could do. Is that what you meant, like without internet or?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So the software interacts with the internet. And some of it is being brought in.
Only the high resolution surfaces of the planets.
Okay. So if you were, you had it downloaded and you were offline.
Yeah.
You could still do it. It just wouldn't be as sharp.
Exactly. And there's just a drop down that says offline instead of default. You just pick the drop down that says offline. And then all of the planets will be set up in offline mode for you. Everything is just as sharp except for when you get close to the planets.
That's great. Okay, thank you. Over to you, Sarah.
Awesome. So you guys, you answered one of the questions that I was going to ask right at the beginning. There are no images of any hydrothermal fields. Is there a possibility that that will get added in at some point? Speaking as someone who just spent 2 months by the Lost City hydrothermal field.
You mean under the ocean?
Yeah, like... Is that something that could be like requested or?
Well, or maybe even better yet, like we could work with someone like you to get those imageries and get them added into the software so that we could share them with people and teach people about it.
That would be really, really cool. Cause that would be so cool to like start under the water and then you fly out and then go out to like Enceladus or something, you know, to make the connection.
Yeah. It's all surface Esri data. So that's why it's not in there.
Exactly. Yeah. But this is how we would get new stuff is by talking to someone who's doing that kind of stuff. And, you know, I guess sometimes there's so much data out there that we can only put in A, what we know about, and B, what we have time about. But then, you know, when we work with someone else, we find out about something, put it in, because they want to show it, help them give a presentation. Okay. And then, oh yeah, that's public data. So then we could put it in and share it for other people. You know, like an example of something like that would be like this CRISM imagery on Mars. So we have all this great Mars imagery that is like the optical imagery, but then someone wanted to present with the spectral imagery and I didn't even know it existed. And we found out the website and now I found out how to add it. And now if people want to present about Mars with the spectroscopy, I have a whole bunch of files they could use, or I can show them how to add.
Cool. I will try to grab your email or something like that, because I would love to talk to you about adding that in, because that would be so, so, so cool for like this. All of this is so cool. I can see so much usage for it as is, but like if we could add that part into, that would be so cool, especially for astrobiology. Like a lot of people in astrobiology, the hydrothermal fields are a good, you know, connection there. So
yeah,
well, very I will grab that from you before you pop out.
Cool. And is just since I'm not like an expert, when you say the hydrothermal fields, is that like what I'm thinking of when I've heard of like the like black smoke vents and stuff?
Yeah, except so I was at the Lost City, which is it's a different type of hydrothermal field, and it's the only one that we know of in the world that is like that so far. Cool. And it's they're called white smokers. They're not really smoking, so that's kind of a misleading term. But I was just out there
underwater kind of.
Yeah.
Cool.
And with the release now of phosphorus in Enceladus, like, wow, that it's just a really cool connection.
Yeah.
That's what we were looking at down there. So
awesome.
Yeah. I will definitely touch base with you because that would be super cool.
I agree.
Well, this is a great segue to move into wrap up mode. And before we thank our guests and say goodbye, I wanted to turn it over to Jessica Swan, who is going to give us a little bit of a preview for next month's gathering. So go ahead, Jessica, over to you.
All right. Yeah, I mean, this was absolutely perfect, and we should totally model this every single time. So you all have met one of the NASA Science Activation Teams, OpenSpace. There are 26 funded teams under NASA Science Activation. There are some 53 teams in total between infrastructure and funded teams. And I hail from the NASA Scope Project, and it is our job to facilitate connections between subject matter experts like yourself and these science activation teams. the really interesting thing to share with you is that we have funding mechanisms to connect you with science activation teams. So Sarah, when I put that in chat, that this is a seed grant fodder idea, there is funding available. You can put in a proposal in collaboration with OpenSpace to get your data into their tool. They benefit, you benefit. It's a win-win. As far as the seed grants go, we offer seed grants between $5,000 and $20,000. There are some stipulations, quid pro quo, blah, blah, blah. We can talk about that later. But it is my hope that I'll be able to bring some other science activation teams like OpenSpace to your next guild meeting so that they can share a little bit about their project and how they're hoping to engage science activation teams. But also, maybe you could come to the table with a slide or two about some things that you would love to incorporate into this education and communication space. So think of it like a 1 to 2 slide pitch deck. And if some SciAc teams are here and they're interested in picking up your idea and running, we might have a match, something that you could write a 2-page proposal around and potentially receive some funding. NOIs for our next funding round close January 31st. And the actual 2-page proposals are due at the end of August. So that's why I'm sliding in here now. And then in July, we'll be bringing the science activation teams to this meeting and talk a little bit more about other ways that you might be able to engage. So anyway, I can hang out here for a minute if there are other questions, but I am cognizant of the time.
Thanks a lot, Jess. Yeah, so we'll be sending more information about this out to you soon in email so we can prepare for next month's gathering. You can prepare a potential pitch. Hopefully some of the other SciAc teams can come and meet you and we'll do some connection making. So do stay tuned for that. So thanks for previewing that, Jess.
Yeah, thanks for the invite.
Yeah, unless there are any more questions or ideas or thoughts to share with our guests, we can move into wrap-up mode.
Thank you all for attending our presentation. Mm-hmm. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much for coming and sharing this amazing resource with us. I think there's a lot of energy around it, and we have it recorded, so we're going to send it out to the whole group. And before we go, I just want to say in the chat real quick, have a look from Hillary. There is a survey. If you have a moment, we would love your feedback, always.
It's really short, and it helps us to know what's really useful to you. And if you have any suggestions, there's also a question you can answer there. So it was just a Google form.
Thanks, Hillary. And thank you again, Megan and Rachel and Micah. This was absolutely breathtaking. Thank you for your beautiful work. And we
thank
look
you.
Forward to collaborating with you more.
Thanks for coming.
All right. Take care, everyone. More coming in email soon, and we'll see you in a month.
Bye.
Bye-bye.